Hello and welcome to this online course. I hope you are doing well and you are staying at home. So this is a course about, a second course actually, of on complex variables. It's called holomorphic functions. So in principle, you should be familiar with many concepts that we shall deal with. But the purpose actually of the second course is a deeper study of holomorphic functions and complex numbers. So not only we shall review things that you already took, but we are going to learn new things, like the principle of analytic continuation, like the problem of existence of an antiderivative, and so on. So I will be posting videos, as I told you, on YouTube, and you can leave your answers in the comments or send me an email. And as usual, everything is on my website. So there will be three chapters. The first chapter is actually very short. We used to give a lengthier chapter when we had 60 hours for this course, but now they reduced to 30 hours. So we had to reduce a little bit the material. So chapter one reviews the notions of holomorphic functions, holomorphy or holomorphicity, if you like, and introduces the concept of analytic function, of analyticity. One of the targets of this course is to prove that the two notions are equivalent, but this is far from being trivial, actually. Okay. So in chapter one, we shall prove one direction, that an analytic function is holomorphic. The converse will prove in chapter two, which is about complex integration, okay, complex integrals. So we shall review Cauchy's formula and so on. And one of the things that we shall prove actually is the fundamental theorem of algebra that states that every polynomial with complex variables, if it's not constant, it has a root. Okay, this is a very important theorem that you may know, but I think that you never proved it. And the third chapter is devoted to Laurent series, which are generalizations of Taylor series or power series, and the residue theorem, yeah, which has many applications in the computations of integrals. Okay, so in principle, it's not a very difficult course, but it requires some seriousness and, as usual, regularity in your studies. And so, once again, don't let things accumulate before the exam. Yeah, now I don't know when the exam will be, but profit from your staying at home to study a little bit. Okay, so let us start with chapter one. We start with a small notational review. So the complex numbers, the set of complex numbers denoted by this C, it's a field, if you like, algebra. So it has an addition and a multiplication, which makes it a field. It's also a vector space. It's a vector space over R, and as a vector space over R, it has dimension 2. Now, because why? Because actually C is isomorphic to the plane R2, and of course, as a vector space over itself, it has dimension 1. Okay, so C is actually isomorphic. Why? Because actually a complex number, think of a complex number as a couple. So a complex number is of the form x plus iy, so it's a couple xy. And the modulus of a complex number is actually the norm of the couple, the Euclidean norm of the couple xy, if you like. So equipped with this norm, the modulus is the norm, actually, and so this makes C a Banach space. And so as a Banach space, it's also isomorphic. There is a topological isomorphism between C and R2. So actually, we can identify C with the plane, with R2, which is can be represented as a plane. Okay, so we talk about the complex plane. Okay, so algebraically and topologically, C and R2 are the same. This is why we identify them. But there is a caveat here, is that when we say R2, there's no multiplication in R2. So as a vector space, actually, not as a field, because R2 is not a field. Okay, so I already did this, that in a complex number is a couple, actually. This is the rigorous definition of a complex number. It's a couple. Okay. And now we review the notion of holomorphic function. Okay, and for a notation omega, we shall consider all the time functions defined on an open set of C, because the function need not be defined on the whole plane. It's defined on a subset of the plane that we usually take to be open. And I will tell you why we need this assumption of openness in a moment. So if omega is an open subset of C and f is a function from omega to C, so it's a function of a complex variable and it takes complex values, okay? So we say, so if z0 is a point in omega, we say that f is a holomorphic at z0. So we first start with the notion of holomorphicity at a point. Now another name for holomorphic is C differentiable, okay? So what does it mean that for a function to be holomorphic at a point? It simply means that Newton's ratio that you are already familiar with tends to some limit, has a limit as the denominator tends to zero. Okay, so it's the same notion that you learn for real variables. But now there's a big difference actually here. Why? Because we are working now in C, which has a multiplication, it's a field, and not with R, which is one-dimensional. So here we have this condition actually, as we shall see, is more restrictive than the simple differentiability of a function of a real variable. But the definition looks the same. Okay? So this is the definition. I hope you are familiar with it. And if in this case, if f is holomorphic at the point z0, the limit is denoted by f prime of z0, or df over dz at z0. Okay, and f prime of z0 is called the derivative at the point z0. So it's a complex number. And as usual, if f is holomorphic at every point of omega, we say that f is holomorphic on omega. And we have now a new function in this case, which is called denoted by f prime. Okay, it's called the derivative of f. So don't confuse derivative with derivative at the point. The derivative at the point is a complex number. The derivative on a set is a function, is a new function. Now, if you go back to the definition of limits, if we call C the limit in the definition f prime, so if f prime of z0 is denoted by C, which is the limit, then saying that the limit is equal to C is exactly given by this condition that you learn in first year. What does it mean? It means that the distance between the Newton's ratio and the limit can be made arbitrarily small, smaller than any positive number, provided the denominator is small enough. This is the meaning that, okay? This is the epsilon delta or epsilon alpha definition. Okay, now if I multiply by z minus z0, I get this condition. Okay, I multiply both sides by modulus of z minus z0. And so this is equivalent. Why I'm writing this actually? Because if I write z minus z0 as h, which tends to zero, okay, then I get this condition that the difference between f of z0 plus h and f of z0 minus the derivative times h is what we call a small o of h. This is just a notation, actually. In principle, you encounter this notation in differential calculus. But this is just a notational rewriting of the previous line. Okay, so there's nothing new. It's just a notation. Now, this should look familiar to the notion of differentiability that you studied in math 3302, differential calculus. The idea is the same, actually. The idea is that we approximate the function by a linear function locally near z0. Okay, so it's the same idea as approximating the graph of a function locally by its tangent. This is the notion of differentiability. So the idea is the same. However, because C is a field, this condition is stronger than the notion of differentiability that you studied in differential calculus. So, but they look the same, okay? So And now I want to talk about the link between the two, because since we can identify C with R2, the function f from omega to C gives rise to a function of two variables taking their values in R2. So this is what we call a vector field, function of two variables and having two components, okay, because every complex number is a couple, and so okay, so we need a couple as input and a couple as output. So this is what we call a vector field, and I will tell you why we call this in a moment. Okay, so here we identify actually the function f with its function of two variables that we denote by f tilde. Okay, so I will give an example right now. So you know that every function has a real part and imaginary part. Okay, so f tilde is actually just u and v, but considered as functions of a real variable of two of a couples. Okay, now I'll give an example right now. And I told you that usually we don't write this f tilde, we just continue to note by the same symbol f. So for example, if you take f of z equals z square, what is f tilde in this case? This is not difficult. We just write z equal x plus iy and we raise to the power 2. And if we separate the real part and imaginary part, we get x squared minus y squared as a real part. So this is u, this is what we call this real part, the real part. And the imaginary part is 2xy. So we really get a function of two variables having two components. So we have two variables, xy, and we have two components separated by a comma here. Now, you may ask, so this is then just to illustrate the notion between the link between f and f tilde, but in practice we still denote f tilde by f, okay, but this depends on the point of view. If you want to consider f as a function of a single variable or of two variables, single complex or real. Now you may ask, so why do we call it a vector field? Because if at every point xy, I draw a vector whose component are the first component and the second component. So, for example, if at the point of coordinates xy, I make an arrow having two directions or two components. So, this is the first component, this is the second component. So, this is the vector actually. So, I consider xy as a point in the plane, and this I consider it as a vector. What do I really get, actually? In this case, I get this picture that tells us why we call such function of two values a vector field, because at every point, I have a vector pointing in some direction. Okay, so here I plotted this vector, this particular vector, actually, near the origin. So it's here I took x and y between minus 1/2 and 1/2. So note that, for example, at 0, the vector is 0. Yeah, but there's a small error in printing here. So it's zero here. So it's small near zero. When we get far from zero, we get a bigger arrow. Yeah, because the x and y gets bigger and bigger. Yeah, so you see that they are not the same size. So this is one way of representing complex variables. Okay, to picture them. And of course, we can also plot the modulus of it, and then we get a surface. Okay. And for this new function of two variables, so if you consider a function of complex variable as a function of real, as a vector field actually, for this function from R2 to R2, we have the notion of R differentiability or just differentiability that you studied in Math 302. What does it mean that f is differentiable in the sense of Math 302, or Fréchet differentiable, if you like? The idea is the same, is that we can approximate locally f by a linear map, okay? So this should be familiar from the course that you took last semester. So the difference, so this is f, and we approximate it by a linear map. Now, a linear map in two dimensions is just a matrix. So this is the meaning of differentiability, okay? But we had a similar thing for C differentiable. Now, what is the relation? We have two notions now. They look the same, but they are not the same. Okay, because here we are working, we are working in R2 as a vector space, and in the first definition of holomorphy, we worked in C as the field, so where we had a multiplication. Here we are not multiplying two vectors. And note that here we use the same H actually. We'll consider H as either a complex number, H1 plus IH2, or as a couple, H1, H2. And then actually the modulus of H is the same as the norm of H. This is just the Euclidean norm. Okay. So if U and V denote the components of F tilde, or the real version of F, if you like, if F tilde is R differentiable, then it has partial derivatives. You know that. And the Fréchet derivative is just the matrix of partial derivatives. Okay? This, in principle, you learned in... So the operator L here is just this matrix. Okay? So this is the notion of R differentiability for the real version of a complex function, okay? Now, the relation between the two conditions is given by this proposition. So, saying that, though, so there are three equivalent conditions, actually. Saying that F is C differentiable or holomorphic at the point Z0 means precisely the same thing as saying that F is R differentiable, and there's something more here, the derivative has a special form, okay? So C differentiable is something very restrictive, okay? There are many differentiable functions, but there are less holomorphic functions. And now, the fact that the partial derivative has this special form means what? Means that the partial derivatives on the diagonal are equal, and the partial derivatives at the other diagonal are opposite. Okay, so these equations are known as the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay, so C differentiability is equivalent to R differentiability plus a very restrictive condition called the Cauchy-Riemann condition or Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay, so C differentiability is much stronger than R differentiability. Okay, the proof is not difficult. So I would prove that implies two equivalent to three, and three implies one. But three implies one is essentially the same as one implies two, because we can go back the steps. So suppose first that C is differentiable, and let small c be the derivative at Z0, which I write as alpha plus I beta, where alpha and beta are the real and imaginary parts. So if I go back to the definition of holomorphic that I wrote earlier, we get that the difference between f of Z0 and, so f of Z0 plus h minus f of Z0 minus this linear term, this is a linear term in h, is a small o of h. Meaning that when I divide by a modulus of h, the ratio tends to zero. Same thing. Now, I write h. So here I have a double point of view, actually. So I view the number h either as not only as a complex number, h1 plus h2, but also as a vector. Okay. So because the two points of view are the same. So if I write this term, I can write it this way. And I replace C by alpha plus I beta. So I get this term. So the difference, or the increment of F, this is what you can call delta Y, delta F if you like. So this term is just the difference, the increment of F. And this is the linear part. This is the derivative here. Okay, I know that all this is a small o of H. Okay, and now what I do is I separate the real part and imaginary part. Okay, so I just rewrote this term. I separated the real part from the imaginary part. And now, this is a complex number, so it's actually a couple. If I write as a couple or as vector, same thing. Here I should have written H1, H2 in a column, but it's not really important. So the real part of F is U, right? The real part of the derivative is this one, okay? So this is the first component. And the second component, I look at the second component, it's V, this is V minus V, and this is this one, okay? So this is just writing the complex number as a vector in R2, as a column vector, if you like. And now, if you look at these two terms, they form a vector. I can write this vector, actually, as a matrix times a vector, H1, H2. So actually, I should have written here H1, H2. If I do the multiplication, I get alpha H1 minus beta H2, first component, beta H1 plus alpha H2, second component. Okay? So you should see here why, where does this special form come from? And now, this should be equal to what? This should be equal to small o of h. And this is precise. So I found a linear a matrix, which has a special form, approximating f locally. And this is precisely the condition of Fréchet differentiability, or R differentiability, that you studied earlier. So what we proved here, by looking at the complex number as a couple, or as a vector, or as a column vector, we see that C differentiability implies R differentiability, but with something extra, actually. The derivative is not an arbitrary matrix. It's a very special. Usually a matrix needs four parameters. Here we just have two. Okay, so it's a special, it's a very special form of derivative, actually. So this is one implies two. And you see here that the steps are reversible, actually. So if we start with here, with this last line, you can go back. So if this is true, if this condition is true, which is just R differentiability with a special matrix, then if you go back to the steps, we get precisely this C differentiability condition. So this condition here is precisely equivalent to this condition here. Okay, so this, so not only one implies three, but two implies one, actually. One and two are equivalent. Now, this is what I said. Now, two is equivalent to three. Why? Because if f is R differentiable, then the derivative is this matrix of partial derivatives. So this matrix of partial derivative should have this special form. This means that the cross derivatives here are equal, and these two are opposite. And these are the familiar Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay? So, yeah, we already did that. I said it orally. So, in summary, this is the relation between C differentiability, or holomorphicity, if you like, and differentiability that you studied in. So C differentiability is R differentiability plus a very restrictive condition. Okay, so not all functions, the majority of functions are not holomorphic, actually. So holomorphic functions form a very special class, but it's a very useful class, actually, as we shall see. Okay, what else? So, yeah. Now, I have two remarks. Our computations, so know that if we write the Cauchy-Riemann, we know that f prime of z0 is the number alpha plus I beta. But this is alpha, this is beta. So we can write f prime of z0 in the following way, in four ways actually. Alpha plus I beta, alpha minus I minus beta, because these two are opposite actually. And we can write in this way, And there's also a fourth way. We can also write del v over del y minus del u over del y, minus I del u over del y. So there are four ways of writing the derivative by using the relation between them, the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay, this is the first remark. And the second remark, you know what is the norm of a matrix as a linear bounded operator. If you, from differential calculus, by definition, the norm of an operator, because now this is an operator or a matrix, if you like. So what is the Euclidean norm of the matrix? By definition, it's the supremum of the norm of the operator evaluated at h for h in the unit ball. Okay, this is, by definition, the norm of an operator. So actually, so we have two things, actually. We have, if you go back to the difference between f and f tilde, which are the same, actually, f prime of z0 is a complex number, so it has a modulus. And the Fréchet derivative of f tilde is a matrix, so it has also a norm. And what I claim is that the two numbers coincide. So the norm of the Fréchet derivative, which is a matrix, is equal to the norm of the derivative. Why? Here's the proof. So write h as a vector, as a column vector, h1, h2, and write the Fréchet derivative as a matrix of having this special form. Then, as you already observed, if I do the multiplication, this matrix times this vector, I get this vector. And therefore, the norm of this vector is actually what? It's the Euclidean norm. So it's the first component squared plus the second component squared, everything raised to the power 1/2. And if I do the computations, you can do the computations here, you can simplify actually. What is inside the square root is precisely equal to alpha squared plus beta. Just do the computations, not difficult. So here we get alpha squared h1 squared plus beta squared h2 squared minus 2 alpha beta h1 h2 plus. So the terms in h1 h2 cancel each other. So we get, after simplification, this thing. And now, what is the supremum? This just a radical of alpha squared plus beta squared, which is the modulus of f prime of z0, times the norm of h. And the supremum of this is when norm of h is 1. So I get precisely alpha squared plus beta squared to the power 1/2. So the maximum of this quantity, when this is 1, is radical of this. So, which is precisely, by definition, the modulus of the derivative. So we have now a link between the norm of the derivative as an operator and the modulus of the complex number. So yeah, so this clarifies the second relation. And yeah, I think I'll just give some example. You should be able to prove, by going back to the definition, that Zn, for any integer, positive or negative, is actually holomorphic on the whole, everywhere. So holomorphic on C. And its derivative is nZn minus 1. Of course, when n equals 0, I get 0, because when n equals 0, it's just a constant. Okay? It's 1. I'm not going to prove this, but you should be able to prove it. If I ask you someday, just go back to the definition and write Newton's ratio, if you like. Because it's the same rule as for real variables. Okay? And therefore, every polynomial in particular is holomorphic everywhere, and its derivative is given by the usual formula. Okay? You should be able to prove that. And you should be able to prove that the sum of two holomorphic functions is holomorphic, and the product of two holomorphic functions is holomorphic. So same rules for real calculus. The inverse of a holomorphic function is holomorphic, provided that the function doesn't vanish, of course. If it doesn't vanish at a point, it doesn't vanish on a neighborhood of that point, actually. This comes from continuity. I didn't say that a holomorphic function is continuous. So holomorphic implies continuity. Why? Because differentiability implies continuity. Okay, so. But holomorphic is much more than continuity. Okay. The composition of two holomorphic functions is holomorphic. This is something, so same rules, exactly the same rules. And you should be able to prove these things. Now, however, if I consider the function z bar, so z bar is, if x, z equal x plus iy, z bar is x minus iy. If you look at the components, x minus and minus y, they are C infinity. So of course, this function, yeah, the vector field x minus y is R differentiable, but it's nowhere holomorphic. Why? Because the Cauchy-Riemann equations are nowhere satisfied. Okay, so this is a counterexample proving that there are more R differentiable functions than holomorphic functions. And the last example, so you should be able to write the details. I'm saying these orally, but you should be able to do. Now, if an example of a function holomorphic only at a point is given by the modulus of z square. Now, the modulus of z square is also R differentiable because the modulus of z square is just x square plus y square, and this is, of course, differentiable. It has partial derivatives of all orders. So, of course, it's R differentiable. And it's holomorphic only at z equals 0. Why? Because if you write the Cauchy-Riemann equations, they are only satisfied when x equal y equals 0. Write them if you like. So u in this case is x squared plus y squared, and v equals 0 in this case, because this is a real, the modulus of the square is a real number. So u is x squared plus y squared, and v equals 0. And if you look at the derivative, you get 2x and 2y. So 2x equals 0 if and only if x equals 0, and 2y equals 0 if and only if y equals 0. So the Cauchy-Riemann equations are satisfied only at the point. Okay, so I think now I will stop here for today. And so don't forget to ask your questions in the comments or send me an email. And I will see you next time in a new video. And meanwhile, stay safe.